I would like to introduce Mr. John Maguranis from Project Coyote. He is the representative. He has been traveling around teaching the public about coyote and wildlife, and he's going to be doing a presentation, and then he's going to answer all of your questions for you. I would also like to introduce, we're lucky to have a special guest with us, one of the animal control officers in town, Megan, is here, and should be available to answer questions hopefully as well. So thank you for coming, welcome, and I'd like to introduce John Maguranis.
All right, thank you. Appreciate you all coming. I've done a boatload of these presentations all around the state, and I'm always impressed when the animal control shows up. So that tells me that your animal control officer here in North Reading is a good animal control officer, because there's a bunch of them that aren't. I'm an animal control officer right now, presently. So hats off to Megan. All right, so my presentation is Living with Coyotes. It's a small enough crowd, so if you want to throw out a question, I think that'd be fine instead of waiting until the end. That'll work. So this is the eastern coyote. This is what everyone's really concerned about. I have a lot of question marks here because our coyote is actually a wolf hybrid. Somewhere along the line, they made it with wolves, and they're developing this new breed. They're like right in the middle of that transition of evolution. So they're much different than the western coyote. And this is the western coyote, the Wiley Coyote. We all know him. But our coyote is actually a wolf hybrid. So they're bigger than the western coyote. They have some wolf habits and that kind of thing. But they're really mostly all coyotes. So they're really cool. I like them. So today I'm going to talk about factual information. Unfortunately, and this is how it kind of started this whole thing, I grew up in Belmont. I was always out in the woods, skipping school and stuff. And, nature and wildlife was my passion and my thing. And so I graduated from high school and I joined the Army. And I was in the Army for 20 years as a veterinary technician. So I kind of shifted from wildlife to domestic animals. And then when I retired in 2001, a buddy of mine told me that, that Belmont was looking for an animal patrol officer. I said, well, I don't want to be a dog catcher. He said, no, you got to read this job description. So now when if anyone ever says to me, are you a dog officer? I would say, no, it's an animal control officer, because I hate that term. But anyway, so I got going on this thing, and I've been doing all this animal stuff for a long time. But when I started in Belmont, one of the first things I had to deal with was coyote issue. And it was right after the time the first child was bitten by a coyote down the Cape. I don't know if you remember that. It was about 14 years ago. And what had happened was this kid was bitten by a coyote on his back, and the media was like rappelling out of helicopters, filming this, showing the bite, and it was a mauling and all this stuff, and then everything cooled down, and they hunted that coyote down, and they shot and killed it, and they did a necropsy on it, and what they found was a healed long bone fracture in his leg, and it was the type of fracture that had he had that out in the wild, there was no way in the world he was going to survive. So we all kind of thought, somebody took care of this thing. So about 3 months later, a veterinarian came forth and he said, I hit him. I was on my way to work, I hit him, I broke his leg, I brought him to my clinic, I put a cast on him, whatever, did surgery. And for 16 weeks, every single day, he went outside and did this, fed that coyote. So that coyote saw human food, human food, human food. So he got habituated to humans for food. So then the guy was trying to be kind, he let the coyote go, coyote went after food, kid had his school lunch in his backpack and he got bit trying to get the lunch. But the news never came back and told you that. So you're left with an image that coyotes are around attacking children. A couple years ago in, I think it was Woburn or Melrose, maybe Melrose, a gentleman was out New Year's Eve, came home, and said he was attacked by a pack of dirty, stinky coyotes. That was his quote. And the news again was all over it, showing the bites on his arms and the bandages and the interviews and all that stuff. Well, we all saw the bites and said no way that was coyotes. And so they did a little investigation, put a little pressure on the guy, and the truth finally came out months later that it was New Year's Eve. He was drunk as a skunk. He was coming home, and he fell into his barrels where a nice family of raccoons were dining, and they didn't like his presence, and they bit him. But the news never came back and told you that. So again, you're left with the image of a pack of dirty, stinky coyotes attacked this man. So that's how I got into this thing, because it's not fair. If you're going to make judgments, you need to make judgments based on fact. I like coyotes. I think they're neat. I think they have a niche here. They're important for our environment and ecology. You may not, and I'm not here to change your mind, but the facts are the facts. So you can make your judgments based on what I'm going to tell you tonight, which is all factual information. I'll talk about habits, myths, and again, facts. I'll give you some semi-up-to-date data from the state lab that might surprise you. And I'll talk about management and coexistence. One thing about coyotes, they're not going away. They're here to stay. No amount of trapping, shooting, poisoning, gunning, hunting is ever going to get rid of them. Right now, we kill 500,000 coyotes every year. One a minute gets killed. And just think about that number. If it was rhinoceroses or horses or gophers, they'd be extinct in a few years. But they keep bouncing back because they have this thing in their biology that when they get pressure, kill, you know, lethal pressure, they just up their litters. So they're not going away. So we have to deal with them. So we have to make a choice. We either, you know, send the hunters out every year and shoot them all up, and next year they'll be back and we'll do it again, or we can learn to coexist with them. So that's what I'm here to talk about. If we have time, we'll do a little tracking thing so you can identify them if they're in or around your property. We'll talk about human and pet safety. It's always a big issue. Has anyone here lost an animal to a pet, to a coyote? At least they thought they might have. No? Wow. One, at least one cat? Cats? Okay, so the cat's gone out and he's never come back, kind of thing. Okay. Yeah. I frequently see, you know, as soon as a poster goes on a telephone pole of a lost cat, people say, oh, coyote's got him. But as an animal patrol officer, I can tell you, 9 times out of 10, it's not a coyote. It's Chrysler, Ford, or the neighbor's dog. It happens. They get hit by cars and they, you know, they don't get killed immediately. They limp off to the sides of the road and they sometimes in bushes and they die. I've had cats with just skeletons and scan them and found a microchip. And yet the owner was saying he got killed by a coyote. So they get blamed a lot for stuff that isn't actually true.
How do you know that? Because we have not one. I moved up here about 15, 16 years ago. And I don't know how many stray cats we used to have on our property. You know, just when the coyotes seemed to come around, the cats went down. So I associated with that.
I'm not saying they don't eat cats and they won't eat cats. I'm just saying they get blamed for it, and 9 times out of 10, it's not coyotes, it's something else. So it you may have coyotes moving in and wiping out all your cats. I don't know, but I'm saying on average, it's not just coyotes, right? Hazing is a great program. I'm hoping your animal control officer may try to initiate a hazing thing here in the community, but I'll talk about that later. So a little baby coyote. The Animal Rescue League called me a few years ago about a pup, this one, that was curled up in somebody's backyard for like 5 days in a row. And she was concerned about it. This was in Chelmsford. So they called me to come up and evaluate the coyote. So I got up there and he's curled up in a ball sleeping, and I crept up on him and I scooped him up by his neck on purpose, because I want to scare him. I want to be afraid of people, so I want to make that imprint. So I handled him real rough. But as soon as I picked him up, he pooped. And that's a good sign. That means he's eating. And at this age, he's not hunting on his own. So that tells me his parents were around and he was being fed. So we checked him over real well, and I said, you know what, he's a healthy pup. There's a few poops in the yard. So I said, his parents were around somewhere, so we let him go. That's his story. All right, so our coyote, most media-driven animal in North America by far, next to wolves. Anytime a coyote pokes his head out, it's on the news, or, you know, they're calling the police. The animal patrol officers are wasting their time going up there, you know, checking on all these things that really probably come out to nothing. Bart talked about the media. Conflicts and fear and misinformation, this is how we can deal with it. Knowledge conquers fear. So if you're afraid of coyotes, I'm betting anything. I won't bet my Harley, but I'll bet anything. At the end of the night, you'll feel more comfortable about walking around and seeing coyotes. At least I hope you will. And protecting people and pets is just so easy, it's unbelievable. And we'll certainly talk more about that. I'm going to kind of skip over this. Okay, how do they get from one place to another? Here in North Reading, I got here a little bit early, so I drove around, actually looked for something to eat. Couldn't find anything but woods. So it seems to me that it's a very spread out community. There's a lot of land, a lot of houses have land around it. It's a perfect place for coyotes. They can move in at night when people are sleeping in the, you know, in your communities and in neighborhoods. And then during the day, when they don't want to be around people, they can find little secret, you know, quiet places to bed down. But where I live in Belmont, which is like 7 miles from downtown Boston, we always wonder how coyotes get from one place to another. How do they get to New York City? Because now we have coyotes on Long Island. We've had them in Central Park. There's actually a study going on about the coyotes in Central Park. If you ever look at a street map of Central Park, you're like, how did they ever get there? Well, this is one way they get there. Because if you're walking down the tracks and a train comes by, and the conductor sees you, he calls, picks up the phone, calls the police, and they promptly come down and remove you because you're not supposed to be there. So the train tracks are void of people. Although every now and then they have a big thunderous thing running down the road, but it's, in general, there's no people there. So they can get from point A to point B without bumping into any humans at all. So this is like wildlife highways in areas like Belmont, Cambridge, and that kind of thing. All right, now this is really interesting. How did coyotes become wolfish? Where did they get that hybridization? Pre-1850, this was the normal range, this dark area for coyotes. And it was also the normal range of wolves. But we had no tolerance for wolves. We had no compassion for wolves. So we gunned them down, we dynamited them, we clubbed them, we poisoned them, we trapped them, we skinned them, we just wiped them out. And when we did that, that opened this whole area to coyotes. They had no more, nothing to prey on. So their population expanded and they just went all through the United States. And you see this little X right here, this is Algonquin State Park. For some reason, Eastern wolves and Great Lakes wolves allowed coyotes to mate with them. And it's still a, you know, big question mark in the science world, but that's where it all began, right here. And then they, you know, filtered out down east, west, north, south. And so that started this whole wolf hybridization thing. So that's where it started. And it continues today. There's still a study up there. If you go to, what is it, NOVA? No, not NOVA. Oh, you know. It's one of those, I think it might be NOVA. It's nova.org. Type in coy wolf in a search, and there's a little like 30-minute film about that whole area. Pretty cool. And I met those people. They're really awesome. So anyway. This is another coyote, she's pretty. As you see, I'm very close to this coyote. And actually, when I took the picture, it was probably about from here to there from her. So that tells me she had a lot of exposure to people. And see, this is the thing about coyotes. Most people, when they see it for the first time, they do this. Uh-oh, that's trouble. And they start backing up, or they go around them, or they run away. So the coyote's sitting there thinking, wait a minute, whoa. I'm supposed to be afraid of them, but they're running away from me. So after a few times, they get conditioned to that. They learn, they're smart. So they think, oh, you know what? People aren't gonna bother me. They're gonna give me space. So then they start walking up on people's porches, through their backyards, and before you know it, people calling the police. This thing is aggressive. Being on your porch and walking through your backyard is not aggression. It's just learned behavior that he's not really concerned about you. But if you ever watch a coyote coming through, you watch his ears and his eyes. He knows every step you're at. And if you were to make one move toward him, he's gonna go. Almost guaranteed. Almost guaranteed. We'll talk about hazing in a little bit. Another, just took this picture. This is an amazing animal. He has a mate that we know of. He's been on a golf course down in Cambridge for the last 3-4 years. His mate is super lame. She can't hunt because she has a really bad leg. And he feeds her and they stay together. For at least the last 3 years. And that's a lot of work for him to have to get enough food for himself and his mate. But for the last 3-4 years, that's what he's been doing. Okay, so a bit on their natural history. They mate for life. January, February is an important time for everybody to understand because January, February is when testosterone is high. They're competing for space, territory, competing for mates. So they become territorially aggressive, and they have been known to attack large dogs. Usually we worry about small dogs, cats kind of thing. But January, February, they're filled with testosterone. We know what that does, right? So they will go after a big dog. So January, February, if you want to prevent your dog from being attacked, just put him on a leash. Coyotes don't want anything to do with people. And as long as he's on, there's a human on the end of the leash, you don't really have much to worry about.
Because we had such a rough January, February, what will that do this year, do you think?
In terms of?
The breeding.
Well, the breeding season is done. I mean, they should already have their territories established. They're probably looking for den sites at this time. But as far as dogs go, they're back to normal. All that testosterone is weeded out, and they're not going to be territorially aggressive. And they're not all like that, but some of them can be like that. So the pups are cared for by both a male and a female. Has anyone ever heard of coy wolf? No, what do they call them? Yeah, coy dogs. Okay, let me tell you something about coy dogs. There aren't any coy dogs running around. And the reason is, I mean, it's possible. Coyotes can mate with dogs because they're in the same family. So they can mate, have puppies, and the puppies can survive. But only under a few circumstances. Dogs come into heat twice a year. Coyotes once, January, February, that's it. And they come into heat once a year because they have to have their pups very early, end of April, early May. And then the parents teach the coyotes all summer long how to be good coyotes, and that's that. But dogs come into heat twice a year. So if a male coyote mates with a female dog, then, and it's in January, because she's in heat in January, because you know she can be in heat anytime, then we're looking at her having pups July, August. There's not enough time to train those puppies to be good coyotes, so they're not going to make it. The attrition rate for naturally occurring coyotes is 50 to 70%. So if a coyote has 10 puppies, you're only going to get, you know, three or four of them left over. So anyway, that's the deal on coy dogs. It's just the timing is, it has to be absolutely right. And if the male is the dog and he mates with a female coyote, well, he's not going to protect the den. He's not going to bring food back to the den. He's not going to do anything. So those pups are left with mama, and usually if she leaves the den to go get food for her pups, they can get preyed on by other predators. So the chances of coy dogs actually existing is really slim. But you hear people say it all the time, oh, I saw a coy dog. They're just coyotes. They're not coy dogs. And also, most animals, wildlife, once they're born in the spring, they go all through summer with their parents. October, November, they disperse. Coyotes can either disperse or they can stay. And some will stay a year or two and actually help the parents rear other litters. But they're bottom on the totem pole in terms of hierarchy. They can't mate, they can't stake out territory within their parents' territory. They eat last, whatever's left over, and that kind of thing. And they can leave and come back. And that's it. So, and I'll tell you something kind of cool. A friend of mine, Dr. Jonathan Way, he's a coyote researcher. He's based out of Barnstable. Known him for years and years and years. He's I don't know how long ago it was, but he was doing DNA work. And being a retired vet tech, this coyote got hit by a car in Belmont. So I knew he was doing DNA work, so the thing was fresh. So I drew a file of blood and I mailed it down to him. And about 3 years later, he calls me up all excited. He says, "You're not going to believe this." I said, "What?" He said, "You remember that coyote that got hit by a car in Belmont?" I said, "Yeah." He said, "It's actually a pup from one of the pairs that I have that I'm studying down here in Barnstable." So that thing traveled all the way from Barnstable to Belmont, of all places. You know, I'm the coyote guy. I got hit by a car. It was amazing. Anyway, I think it's cool. All right, so dens are usually reused, but in urban areas, suburban type areas like here, most likely the dens get discovered, and once they're discovered, they're going to move the pups or not den there the next year. But the den site itself would be pretty much the focal point of their territory. This was a coyote in Belmont. We have one dinky little farm, and he was out there, and he was scared to death because some lawn contractors were cutting lawn near his den, and he just wanted to get back to it, but they were in the way, and I was there because the police called, and so I got some good pictures. But I could see that if you were walking down the street and you looked over your shoulder, and he's very wolfish looking, I could see where that might make you a little bit scared. And I'm not afraid of them because I know all about them, and I've been around them so many times, and I've never had any aggression towards me at all. But I can understand why people be a little bit afraid. But trust me, you can scare him off. I'm going to skip over that. Pairs, they mate for life. Once one of the alpha pairs are killed or die or whatever, it really disrupts the group. We tend not to say packs because they're not wolves, they're coyotes, and if you see 6, 8, 10 coyotes together, they're all related except mom and dad. Those are the only two that won't be related. The rest are all pups from this year, last year, maybe the other years. But it's not a pack. Wolves pack because they eat big things, and they need big animals and lots of them to bring those things down. So they recruit wolves. So the strength of a wolf pack is their numbers. And they need it because they, like I said, they eat big things. Coyotes don't, they'll eat anything that comes along. But I just lost my thought because I looked over my shoulder, I thought I hit the slide. But anyway, what was I saying? All right, driving on. All right, so here's something that's very important. It is kind of hard for people to understand. This is proven by research. Say this circle right here is a territory. Say it's a mile square, and you have a pair of coyotes in that territory. And your animal control officer knows that she has a pair of coyotes in there. And then somebody calls up that's got a lot of money, and Ben's the chief's here, and the chief says, you know what, I want you to go kill him. So she goes out there doing, being a good soldier, and she kills these coyotes. Research tells us that once you kill them, younger, inexperienced coyotes can move into that territory and divide it, and sometimes even up to thirds. So now your animal control officer has 4 to 6 coyotes to deal with every year and their pups, as opposed to the male and female. And it's really hard for people to understand that because we grew up knowing that, 2 minus 2 is 0, but not in the coyote world. They rebound and they fill in those spaces, and you go out there and start trying to kill them, you're going to end up with a whole lot more coyotes. And only that, if they don't have experienced parents to teach them, then those coyotes become nuisance coyotes where they're, causing troubles in one way or another. So it's really important for people to understand that coyotes also will not let any other coyotes in their territory. So once they set one up, any coyotes that are coming by, they'll bark and howl and communicate, and the other coyote's just going to leave because he knows that territory is taken. So no other coyotes are coming in unless you disrupt the group. Everybody understand that? Because it's really kind of important. No? Yes? All right, wake up. Am I boring you? I don't want to be boring. That's the worst thing in the world. All right, so the female tends to the pups at the den site. The male does his thing. We believe that the female selects the den site, does the actual digging. And let me tell you, they can dig a den very quickly. Phenomenal diggers, phenomenal swimmers as well. Once they have pups, obviously, there's a higher demand for food. So in the spring, you get a lot of calls because dad's out there, frantically trying to get food for his pups. And the average pups around here, is about 5. And they have the same gestation period as a dog, 63 days. So that wraps that. These guys, I'm not sure if they're still out at the Stone Zoo or Stoneham Zoo. Is it Stone or Stone?
Stone.
Dr. Way had a captive coyote study. He got like 5 coyotes that were like weeks old, bottle fed them and all that stuff, and brought them up to the zoo to do this captive coyote study, and invited me out there. It was really neat because I got there before him. And if you look, this line right here, the ground kind of dropped off. So when I got there, they were all behind here. They poked their head up every now and then, very nervous that I was there. I wasn't in their pen, but they had a big glass wall. So they knew I was there, and they were very nervous, pacing and all that. When Dr. Way got there, he walked in the pen door, they were all over him like dogs. It was amazing. Actually, took the pictures out of my presentation because I don't want to give people the wrong idea. But they were on his lap, licking his face. It was just amazing. Really cool. And I'm not sure if they're still there, but they might be. These are some puppies. Okay, where do they den? A lot of predators like to den on a hillside, and there's a reason for that. When the sun comes up in the morning, heats the air, causes a thermal updraft, and that brings scents of food, you know, right past the den. It also brings scents of danger or other predators. So they can just poke their head out of the den and sniff around and smell what's going on. Also being on a hill, they get a good field of vision. I've encountered a bunch of dens that are on flat ground, under sheds, under trees, and that kind of stuff. So it's not 100% on a hill, but a lot of them I've found have been on a hill.
How big is the opening?
No, it's about like this. And if you see an adult coyote come out of one, you're like, wow, how the heck they fit? But that's another thing we'll talk about, because a lot of people look at coyotes and think, well, that thing's 80 pounds or 60 pounds. There's no 68 or 80 pound coyotes around. They may look that way, but they're not, I can guarantee it. They get 5 inches fur in the winter. So they're 5 inches bigger. They really fluff out, and they look a lot bigger, but they're light as anything. I just pulled one out of a creek last week, a male, an adult male. And when I looked at him in the water, I thought, he's pretty healthy. I was thinking maybe 30, 35 pounds. When I finally got him out of the water, if he was 20, we were lucky. That's how light he was. It was just nothing to him. But once all that fur dries, and he looks bigger. But anyway, so yeah, they can den just about anywhere. This stuff is an invasive plant. I always forget the name of it. It's got really sharp needles. You know, with thick fur, they could just run through it, no problem. But it gave me a lot of problems just trying to get down to the den and look at it. This stuff here, sumac. This was taken in the fall, but in the summertime it grows really thick. And I think there was a den, it was either right here or there. I think it was right in here. And about right here was this walking path. A lot of people walked with their dogs. And I thought, really odd location. But it was probably an inexperienced mom, because she hasn't been there ever since. They could use old construction stuff. They could den just about anywhere. So they can live up to about 13 years. I'm thinking around Belmont, where we have, you know, 95, Route 2, Mass Pike. Probably we'd be lucky to get 9 years out of them. Around here, I could see them living 13 years. And there was one captive coyote that lived 19 years. I'm not sure where it was. Being in the dog family, they get all the same dog diseases, parvo, distemper, rabies, barely, hardly, fleas, ticks, lice, all that kind of stuff, whipworms, heartworms. And I don't know if you guys, if anyone ever sets out poison, but if you have a rat problem and you set out poison, you're not just killing rats, you're killing a lot of other stuff. As an animal patrol officer, I can't tell you how many times I've driven out to Tufts and dropping off vultures, red-tailed hawks, you name it, that have eaten rodenticide, you know, a dead rat that died from rat poison, and it just gets carried on. And in coyotes, it lowers their immune system. Most all canines have mange mites in their skin naturally. So that's why your dog every now and then just scratches for a second. And as long as they're healthy, they don't get a mange outbreak. But as soon as that immune system drops, they very frequently can get mange. And that's what happens to coyotes. They eat dead rats or rats that are sick from rodenticide, and it causes their immune system to drop, and boom, they get mange. This is a coyote right near Wolf Hollow, and we have a Wolf Hollow guy right here. I went out there and saw some puppies and stuff, and then as I was leaving, I saw this guy in the field down the street from Wolf Hollow, and I tried to catch him, but this is what a mange, an animal with mange, and this isn't that bad. He has no secondary skin infection, but no fur. See the only patches of fur, a little swollen up here, already pretty thin, you can see his hip bones. You know, so his lifespan was probably pretty short. And another thing about mange is it causes them to itch profusely. So they can't sit still and wait for rabbits and stuff because they're scratching away. So as they sit there and they scratch away, they alert all the prey items and they just leave. So this poor guy probably got it pretty bad. This is a coyote that I captured down on the golf course bordering Belmont. Right across the street from the golf course was our farm. And this guy had really bad mange, as you can see. He's all ripped that open from biting and scratching and chewing. and it was getting cold. It was like this October, November-ish. And the guys at the golf course said, you know, what are you going to do with them? And I said, well, I'm going to take them out to Tufts and have them treat. And then I'm going to bring them back and release them. And they were so relieved because they want coyotes out there because they'll kill the woodchucks that destroy the greens. They'll kill the rabbits that eat the greens. And they'll kill the rats and geese and the geese as well because Fresh Pond golf course is right on Fresh Pond. So they have a problem with geese. So they really wanted them there. When I first met these guys, they were real skeptical of me. They didn't want to give me any information. And then we went in their office, and it was just the whole walls were covered with pictures of coyotes for like 10 years. And I said, this was awesome. So then they realized I liked them, and then they opened up. But they wanted them there because they helped the golf course. And none of the golfers seemed to mind them. They just got a quick briefing at the front desk. If you see a coyote, don't worry about it. They know you're here. They live here all the time. People, oh, okay. And they just kind of go around them, go golfing. You know, it's kind of cool. And the same with the farm. You know, they absolutely want them there because for the same reasons. Woodchucks, rabbits, mice, rats, that kind of thing. So we trucked them out to Tufts and had them fixed up. It's another shot. You see, I mean, with winter coming, you would have had a pretty hard time trying to stay alive. Probably would have got frostbite in here, and that would have been a really bad situation. And if you want, if you really want to, I can show you the release of this coyote. You guys want to see a video real quick? Mm-hmm. Right. So if I extend my time, it was in Newton last week. No, oh, here it is. Who's that guy? All right, I'm going to fast forward it because for some reason it took me forever to get that cage open. Now remember, the animals want to attack people and kill us, right? Come on, John, open that thing. Oh, come on. Here we go. See ya. So that's the killer coyote that wants to attack people. Just want nothing to do with us. And you can see the little blue thing in their ear, his ear? That's a tag from Fish and Wildlife. And I actually saw this coyote, you know, after it took off about, I think it was like 8 months later, I saw it like within 200 feet where I released it. This coyote was a pup found in Waltham, a really bad mange, secondary skin infection. He was hurt bad. Same thing, took him off the tops, they treated him with ivermectin, healed him up, and we set him loose. At the last presentation I did last week in Newton, somebody asked me, he said, well, in the beginning, you said that veterinarian hit him and took him to the clinic and he kept him and then he released him and he was habituated to people. How come these weren't? Because Tufts Wildlife Clinic knows what they're doing. They never hand feed. They have guillotine doors. They put the coyotes out the back. Everything is remote control. As soon as they go out back, the door shuts. They put the food out. It's all natural food, you know, rabbits and all that kind of stuff. And then they leave, they open the door, the coyotes come in and eat. So they never get any human exposure, so they retain that natural therapy. Okay, you know, why can we kill 500 coyotes a year and still have them around? Why are wolves so threatened and coyotes aren't? Well, wolves only eat one thing, ungulates, hoofed animals, deer, moose, elk, that kind of thing. Coyotes will eat anything. Anything that comes along, they're opportunistic. There's not one thing on their plate that they want to go eat all the time. But I study their scat almost daily where I work, and I can tell you in Belmont, about 90% of their diet is rabbits and mice and voles, and occasionally other stuff. But mostly, almost 100% of their food source is mice and rabbits. And all the people that call me about woodchucks because they have gardens, very happy to know that. So they'll eat any of those. When it comes to pets, I really don't want to have a big debate about it. I've got 6 cats and 7 dogs. I would never, ever let my cats outside. And it's not because of coyotes. It's because of cars, dogs, owls. Owls won't pick them up and take them away, but they will kill them and then decapitate them, take pieces back to the nest. but they won't carry them away. So if somebody says, oh, I saw an owl kicking a cat away, there's no way possible. They're not that strong. But the thing about pets is, you own them, you're responsible for their care and well-being. And if you know there's predators out there, don't let them out. It's just that simple. A lot of people, and like I said, I was a vet tech for 20 years in the Army, and I've heard it over and over again. People say, well, cats need to go outside. They have to nurture their wild instinct. It's not true. This thing right here will nurture their wild instinct all day long. You do this, and that'll nurture it. But they don't need to go outside. I'll bet my Harley right now, you won't find a veterinarian on this planet that'll tell you they need to go outside. Because they don't. And it's just that simple. And I know it's tough if you have a cat that's been going out and now you want to change his behavior and bring him in. For 3 weeks, you're going to hear the screaming, the howling, the scratching, the dashing at the door. But you, if you stick to it, you'll reform them. I've got, like I said, I've got 6 cats that are all rescues. All of them wanted to go out. We just stuck to our guns. And none of them care less about going outside at this point in time. So it is doable. So if you have cats, just keep them indoors. Then you don't have to worry about dogs. You don't have to worry about cars. You don't have to worry about birds, coyotes, anything. Small dogs, that's an issue. If you have a backyard that's, you know, goes out in the woods and you just let your little dog outside, it's not going to be good. But there are things you can do. You can put floodlights out there, motion-activated floodlights. Dog goes outside, the lights come on. Step outside for a minute, just say a few words. Because coyotes naturally don't like people. So if they hear your voice, they're going to say, oh, we need to steer clear, and they'll truck on. Let your dog out. But personally, I would, if I had a small dog, which I do, but I have a 6-foot fence, nobody's coming to my yard, I'd have him on a leash. I really would. I would just get, you know, a 20-foot leash, let him out. I'd be out there with him. I know it's inconvenient, but it's just the way it is, because coyotes aren't going away. So you have that option now. You have to pick one. You just let them out and risk them getting eaten, or you put them on a leash, put lights up, and that kind of thing. Summertime, if you have a garden and you got, you know, woodchucks, or you don't want coyotes in your yard, that company that makes Haveheart traps, go to haveheart.com or .net or .org, whatever it is. They have a product that hooks up to your hose. Of course, it's not good in the winter, but in the summertime, you hook it up to your hose, it's motion activated. Something walks by that thing, it shoots a 3-second burst of water. And it will totally startle anything that's out there, and they'll just head on out of it. We've had several people in Belmont that have koi ponds, and raccoons have started to come and start eating their fish, and they bought that product, put it out there, one night, and that was it. No more raccoons. So it's a really good device, and it works. Pinwheels are said to work. But I haven't tested it, so I don't really know. Anyway, also these animals are crepuscular, they're not nocturnal. Crepuscular means that they're more active at night. These are intelligent animals. The reason why they're more active at night is because we're less active. And that's it. They're more active when we're less active. So out during the day, they're not, you know, they're not like owls that have special eyesight, wings, and bats with radar and all that. They're not nocturnal. They're just more active at night because we're less active. But you can see them anytime, day or night. So if you hear that somebody, you know, people call me up, all the time, I love this, I saw her in broad daylight. Okay, does that mean something bad? It's, you know, they're a daytime animal. So a lot of people are surprised. Most people think they're nocturnal, but they're not. They're a high-level predator. Do you guys have bobcats out here?
Bobcats?
Yeah? You've got fishers, and it's not fisher cats, it's fishers. You definitely have fishers, and they're not killing dogs and cats like everyone says they are, too. 15 pounds would be considered enormous for a fisher cat. They just want to eat little mice and rats and stuff and that kind of thing, but they're not out hunting cats. There's no science behind that. So, oh yeah, bobcats. So how about mountain lions? They have one, you know, we got one in Winchester, so, you know, so they say. You have any stray mountain lions come through?
Not saying five.
Sooner or later, you might. All right, so anyway, you don't have a top predator, really. And this is the thing about coyotes. If you know anything about Mother Nature and ecology, there's a balance. That's why we have predators. Predators pick off the old, the sick, the weak, the ones that have a DNA problem and, you know, that nobody can see. That's what predators do. They keep those animals healthy by taking the weak and the old, the sick out. It's just the way nature works. 165 years ago, we shot the last wolf in Massachusetts, although there was one a couple years ago in the West. But, the last thriving wolf population was wiped out in Massachusetts about 165 years ago. So we haven't had a top predator. So what happens? Foxes, raccoons, skunks, possums, all those animals, their populations just go up because there's nothing killing them, right? So now we have coyotes here. So they fill that niche. They communicate much better than me, obviously. They communicate extremely well. A lot of people don't know this, but there was a study out of BC of 10 years ago, and what they discovered was coyotes can replicate their bark, yips, and howls. So each one can sound like three. So if two of them kill a rabbit, and they don't want anyone else coming around, they start doing that. So if you're walking by, you're hearing six coyotes. You're like, whoa, I don't want to be near that pack, right? Who wants to go in there? If there's three of them, now you're hearing nine coyotes, right? So it's a defensive posture to protect their kills. And it's just amazing. It's just an amazing thing. But they know how to do that. They can also climb trees. They used to say the only canine in the world that climbed trees was gray fox. I approve otherwise.
Did you take that picture?
I did not. I wish I did. I took most all these pictures, but that ain't how. Yeah, I've actually seen video on YouTube of a pair of them climbing a tree and eating the apples. Yeah, pretty wild.
Yes.
But this is how they normally hunt. Kind of like foxes. They listen to sounds underneath the snow or open fields or under the leaves and stuff. They've got those big pointy ears. They can really focus on the sound. So they leap up in the air, dig around a little bit more. She's really focusing on it. And I know it's a she because I have her in the freezer. And then bingo, she pulls out
a
bowl.
You have her in the freezer?
Yeah, 2 days after I took these pictures, she got hit and killed by a car in Lexington. Beautiful coyote. Look at the red on her. She's just gorgeous. So I'm hoping somebody will say, you know what, I'll stuff her for you. Or nothing. But anyway, so here it is. You know, this is a bowl. This is what they eat mostly. And if you look at the body size compared to that, that's a wicked good meal. That's a steak, salad, potato, glass of vino on the side, right? And I watched her inside of an hour. She killed three of these. And that's the golf course, so I'm sure they were very happy. Beautiful coyote, though. Yeah, she is really, had a lot of red in here. Really pretty, and unfortunately she got killed. Happens. I love this picture. It's one of my favorite pictures because, you know, I talk about the media, how they come out and they see all this stuff, and if they're wrong, they don't retract. You know, it's the rest of the story. So I already know what y'all are thinking. You're thinking Mr. Coyote is going to attack and kill Bambi, right? Is that what you're thinking? Bambi's going to get in here, right? Right?
No.
Yep.
You know because you've been there, and you do too. But here's the rest of the story. If you look really close, you'll see something right here. And what that is a dead deer. An unethical bow hunter shot the deer, didn't claim his kill, and left it out in the woods. And a friend of mine who was an ethical hunter found it and put out a trail cam. And that's what we got. So, and I also want you to kind of pay attention to this little mark, this area on the coyotes. You can't see it on this guy, you can see it here. As I go through my pictures, you'll see they all seem to have that little, looks like a feathery something. Yeah, but almost all wolves have it. That's where they get it. So yeah, they'll also eat McDonald's if it's available. These are a couple coyotes. We had a deer got hit by a car, so I put a camera up on it, brought the deer out the woods. This is a family. There's an alpha male and female. I believe the alphas are here, and this is one of the pups, who's very submissive. You'll see in another picture here. See how submissive? It's very useful. He's just waiting for mom and dad to finish. And once they're done with, when they got a full belly, then they'll let him eat. All right, so where can you find him? If you were driving by and you happen to look over and see this guy standing there, your mind would probably say, husky, pay no attention, keep driving. And you wouldn't even think about it. But after tonight, after you see all the pictures of coyotes, now you got that silhouette burned in your head. Every time you see a coyote, you'll know it's a coyote, guarantee you. But they're just about everywhere. You can find them everywhere. Sometimes you'll even teach your kids how to cross the road. This one actually looked left and right before she trotted across. You know why? Beautiful picture, see the flap I was telling you about? And if you run your hand over it, you don't feel any difference at all. It's so weird. This is a beautiful picture, and this is the same one that was on that farm. And I can see where people can get scared by these guys. But, you know, I dealt with them so much, I know their behavior. They just don't want anything to be. You want to do a quick track of things? Is there a clock in here? 8 o'clock? Yeah, you want to do a quick tracking class?
Yeah.
All right. Coyotes are naturally shy and elusive towards people, so you may not see them. But if you do, this is the key things. Ears, very pointy, tall. Tail, thick, bushy, always hangs down, never comes out. And yellow eyes. But most times we don't see them. So then you want to, oh, I forgot to tell you, they also mate with dairy cows. It's amazing. Just kidding, that's a real life coyote. You can see the radio collars down in Barnstable. She's part of Dr. Wade's study. She actually was on the chase of a Canada goose and got it.
But she's spotted.
Like, that's just a natural coyote. They did DNA on her. She's 100% coyote. It's just wild,
that
isn't
like
it?
That looks like a dog.
No, a dairy cow.
Cow.
All right, so if you don't see them, the next thing is their scat, because you can always find their scats. I apologize if the picture's bad. It was my old camera. But this is a typical scat. Whenever predators eat meat or blood, the scat comes out dark and black, and that's what you see here. This light-colored stuff were nuts and berries. But this one here is a youth soccer jersey. Just kidding. Of all the scats I've ever looked through, I only found two that actually had something unnatural in it. This is one of them. But now you move up to a good camera because you got a pay raise, and this is what you'll find. You'll see little rodent teeth in there, seed, case of a seed over here, some probably hip bones or something right here. No cats, there's no grandkids in here, nothing. You look really close, it's all you're gonna see, small bones in here. And you can pull that hair out and look at it and you'll see, well, that's a rabbit. Or if it's real short and dark, you'll say, oh, that's probably a rat or a mouse.
Is it safe to touch that with your
I do. Well, actually, I just pull it apart with sticks.
Okay.
You know.
I know, like, with owl pellets, I pull them apart.
Yeah, I mean, I'm not worried about it, you know. I was a vet tech in the Army for 20 years. I mean, pooped on, peed on, vomited on, bled on, you name it. You know, what's a little poop? All right, so here's the tracking part. They're in the canine family, so you got to kind of know the difference between a dog track and a coyote track. Typical dog track is nice and round. You'll see all four toenails. Most of the time, coyote track is oval, and they have two very close together front toenail marks. So that's the huge difference between dog and coyote track. Coyotes are also what's called a direct registering animal, which means their back foot falls in their front foot. So when you look at the track, you're looking at their back foot track. And they're phenomenal about keeping on the same track. I'll tell you something really cool. I don't know how long ago it was, but I was working early shift, 6 to 2, and we had half inch of snow overnight. It was just ending at 5:30, and I was getting ready to work. So I really hurried, went to work. We have this place called Rock Meadow in Belmont. And I pulled in the parking lot, and there's a fresh set of tracks going in the parking lot. So, oh, awesome. Grabbed a camera, threw on my jacket, and I'm following the tracks, fresh. And I'm a pretty good tracker, not an expert by any means, but I can track pretty good. So I'm following this track, and it's fresh. I know it's really fresh. And I'm looking, I know any minute I'm going to see them. And I kept walking, and all of a sudden the track split. So for like a quarter mile, I thought I was tracking one coyote, and I was actually tracking two. And it's typical, mom and pop will
go around their territory just about every day, mark it, check it, smell it, scent it. They're checking for other coyotes, other predators, prey, and all that kind of thing. So getting back to tracking, oval, two toenail prints up front. See that? Even in mud, it's really soft mud, and I have a picture, you'll see the other stuff. But, so you don't even see the other toenails. Again, dog tracks, this guy's fat, overweight, hasn't had his nails clipped in months, right? See that? Look at the picture. So, you know that's a dog track, right? And again, coyote track, nice and oval, two toenail imprints up front. And then this track pattern, you know. These, you know, I've been doing this so long, whenever I find a good track, I try to get a picture of it. But if it's, you know, if you're out there and you see a set of tracks, chances are they're not going to be nice and perfect for you to really, you know, see what it is. So then you look at track pattern. If you take Fido out to the woods, he's probably going to feel like Rin Tin Tin, and he's going to be going from here up to the willow tree, taking a leap, and then running over here, and then back to dad, where's the ball, chase the ball. So his track pattern is going to be all over the place. But a coyote's not. They're very disciplined. They'll go, you know, from A to B. You may find a little dig, maybe even a little bit of blood where they found a mouse and ate it. But their track pattern is going to be pretty straight and disciplined. So side by side, now, they're not to scale, believe me. So this dog track is much bigger than that. So that's that. And this is, again, in mud. See the toenail prints up front, nice and oval. And in really good circumstances, you can see these two rear lobes, which you don't normally see. But in this mud, this particular substrate, you can see them real well. And don't ask me why I didn't grab that little shrimp thing and get it off there before I took a picture. Ah, kills me every time I see that picture. Perfect imprint of a coyote track. It's stupid painted, pull it up. All right, how many bites do you guys think have happened officially in Massachusetts? Now, they've been here since 1940s, 50s, 65, 70 years or so. How many bites do you think we have? Guesses?
Three.
Three?
Five.
Five?
Zero.
Zero. Okay, so you guys know I'm on some. Usually people say 50, 25, 100, but in fact, we've only had five recorded bites from coyotes, and two of them were confirmed to have rabies. And the third one, we believe to have rabies, but we just never caught the animal. So if you compare that to dog bites, Megan, how often do you spend, how much time do you spend in a month doing quarantines?
Probably two shifts, so 6 hours.
Pretty good amount of time, right? Yeah. Dog bites are unbelievable. And that's why if you call me and Megan, you say, there's a coyote in my backyard, we're probably going to say, well, big deal, grab a camera, enjoy it. I'm worried about dogs, okay? And I have another graphic about that. But that's the skinny on coyotes and bites in Massachusetts. We've only had five. Not a big deal. And they're not, they haven't been maulings or, you know, dragged down kind of thing. They've just been bites, you know? It's not a big deal. Coyotes who rely on natural foods stay shy and elusive towards people. Just the way it is. Their activities don't evolve around us. They don't, you know, look at us as a food source. And if you see a coyote scared away, it's wicked easy. So let's talk. Let's see. Am I in the hazing now?
Yeah.
Yeah. All right. Hazing is a community thing. You can do this. I know there seems to be a lot of new like neighborhood associations because I've done a lot of presentations at people's homes because they have these associations. And I think it's a great thing. So everyone has internet now, so everyone's kind of connected. And it keeps neighborhoods nice and close and people are, you know, real neighborly. So neighborhood associations would be a great thing to take up this haze and stuff. But you got to know a couple things. If a coyote encounters a good meal, he's going to remember that. And he's going to return to that area. So if you've got apple trees or whatever in your backyard and they start falling on the ground, you don't rake them up, chances are you're going to have a coyote come by sooner or later and eat those apples. And if people do the usual when they see them and they run away or back up or go around them or whatever, then over time, you know, they're smart. They're like dogs. They learn from that. So they learn not to be afraid of us, so to speak. So in order to
change that behavior, because that's all we're doing, is we're just doing behavior modification. People do it with dogs all day long. What you have to do is you've got to scare them away, and you got to do it completely. And this is it, the hazing. You can scare a coyote by waving your arms, you know, Mass Fish and Wildlife, MSPCA, Animal Rescue League, they all have the same stuff on their website. Wave your arms, bang pots and pans, and all that kind of stuff. I don't know about you, but when I go hiking, I never have pots and pans with me. But what I'm seeing is so many people are doing this that and not properly hazing them, that coyotes see this, and now they're like, I've seen that before. What else you got? So what you got to do is you got to scare them away. And you can pick any way you want to. The way I scare them is I look straight at them, and I just start walking. That's an aggressive posture. And coyotes, and it's really, I love doing this because I can almost gauge how much prior experience they've had with people by how close I get to them. But sooner or later, you see them perk up, and you can just see them thinking, this guy means business, he's different, and they get off and take off. Okay, now if he gets up and he runs away, am I done? No, this is where people screw up. If you haze a coyote, throw something near it, wave your pots and pans, whatever you do, and he runs away, you're not done. You've got to watch him, because coyotes will typically run away 50 yards or so, stop, turn around, and reevaluate. And that's when you've got to haze him again. Because if you don't, if you're walking away already, then you just taught him all that stuff you did to scare him initially really didn't mean much. So now he's really feeling comfortable around people. So next time he goes to your neighbor's yard, so John said to do this, and they go out there and do that, and he just looks at you like, okay. Then they're going to call the police, and they're going to go down and shoot him. And then you're going to end up with more coyotes. So to haze coyotes, you've got to do it properly. And that's all it is. You scare them any way you want to do it. I don't recommend throwing things directly at them, because if you hit them and injure them, then nobody can really predict the behavior of a wild animal that's now injured and in pain. So you don't want to do that. You throw things near them, that's great, that works. But like I said, all I've ever had to do to scare a coyote is just walk straight toward them, and eventually they get up and leave. And most of the time, it's like the first three steps. As soon as they see I'm heading that way, they perk right up and they start moving out. The other thing about hazing is, you don't need to. Like, say you've got a pretty big backyard, and just look out the window, there's a coyote out there. And you go out your back porch, and he sees you and just kind of doesn't bolt, but he trots away a little bit. That tells you that he has a fear of you, and he's moving away from you. So you don't need to haze him, because if you haze him and you don't do it properly, then you're just teaching him that it's okay to be close to people. So only haze those coyotes that need to be hazed. Those are the ones that, you know, that you come outside and they just don't move, you know. You know, those are the ones you gotta haze. And you gotta be brave, you know. You see all these pictures of coyotes, some of them look real scary. But I can promise you, if you start approaching them, they're gonna go, unless they're sick. And anyone with a little bit of common sense can look at an animal and say, there's something not right with him. You know, the eyes might be cloudy, you might have discharge in the nose, they might be kind of walking like this. You know, if they're sick, call animal control, we need to get them out of the food chain. You can set up little hazing groups in your communities. Everyone's on the internet, everyone's got cell phones now. You know, if a coyote starts trotting through your neighborhood and he doesn't appear to be afraid of anyone, then get your hazing group out there. It's always more fun with more people. And it will certainly have more of an impact on the coyote if three or four people start charging them. So you can form these little neighborhood hazing groups and do it. Just the thing is be brave, stand your ground, show your dominance. If you got young kids with you, tell them to open the jackets like this, make them look big. Yes, sir.
Does it matter if there's more than one coyote?
No.
So you can haze. We came across like three of them.
Yep.
So
yep.
You can do the same thing.
Certainly. Yep. Absolutely.
They're not any braver when they're in numbers. So.
No. And you know, in the fall, when like before dispersing time, like
like late September, early October. The parents of coyote pups let them explore their territory without them being right underneath their wing. So in the fall, I'm sure Megan gets a slew of calls, I get them too. What we find is a lot of pups are out there, and they look full grown. You can't look at them and tell they're a puppy. So they're just curious, and they see people and dogs for the first time, they're like, wow. They'll kind of keep their distance, but they'll be looking at you. They might you might see one ahead, and then they kind of trot away, and then all of a sudden they're over here. You know, people say they were circling me, like great white sharks or something, you know. But they do kind of do that. You know, you'll see them over here, and then they're over here. If it's September, October, it's most likely it's just pups that are just, they're out away from their parents, and they're just checking things out. And they may see people for the first time, or your dog. Wow, what's that? Is that a coyote? What is that? You know, so they're curious, they're intuitive, and they tend to kind of check people up. Yes, sir?
Yeah, where coyotes have a normal roof in the top of the yard, we see one. I haven't seen them personally. My wife has. My neighbors have seen them every morning about 7:20 to 7:30 walking up the fairway. 7:10. Does he have a definite roof that he's going to follow?
That one sure does. That's no question. I study coyotes every day, you know, and I know some of the places they like to go to. For the past 3 weeks, there's been a pair of coyotes in one spot almost every single day. So, but I kind of know why they're there. They're on these leaf piles, and as leaves decompose, they give off heat. So when it's cold, they lay up in the leaf piles because it's nice and warm. But all of a sudden, in the last 3 weeks, this pair showed up, and they've been there almost every day. And I go, I pull down, I'm about 200 feet away. They look at me, they check me out a little bit, and they settle down. And sometimes I could just see their hair tips, because they're on top of the leaf pile. And if I even open the window a little bit, just that little sound, all of a sudden the ears come up, or they're looking. So they're very in tune, you know, they might be trying to nap, but those ears are like right on. All right, I'm running from off at the speed up. All right. Okay, so hazing, very easy to do. You can get real scientific, and keep a log, date time, you know, what kind of behavior the animal had, get some coloring. Sometimes you will have a rogue coyote that's not responding to hazing, and he may have to be removed. So you want to kill the right one if you're going to have to do that. So try to get pictures on that kind of stuff. Yes, ma'am.
I guess maybe you're
not
talking about it now. What if there is a confrontation with a dog?
If it's on leash, it hardly ever happens. I've only read in the past 14 years of one account of a woman down the Cape, just got out of the car with two dogs, they were both on leash, she was going in the house, and two coyotes came right up, nose to nose, and she threw the dogs in the car and closed the door and they left. And there wasn't any confrontation, you know, biting or anything. But they did come right up to her, which is really rare. It's as rare as being bitten by one. So, but normally, if you're on the end of that leash, you shouldn't have any issues at all. If you have a small dog and you do see coyotes around, I recommend you pick him up, stick him in your jack a little bit so he doesn't get away from you, and just leave the area. But most of the time, as long as you're right there, there should be no issue at all. All right, so I just want to bring this up real quick because, you know, again, being an animal control officer, this is what I'm much more concerned about. 15 to 20 people die every single year in the United States from being killed by dogs. And I'm not trying to dog dogs. I love them more than anything on this planet. That's why I got seven of them. But they can cause a lot of damage, and they do. So if you call Megan or if you call me and you tell me you got a coyote running through your yard, like I said, big deal. This is what I'm worried about right here. Alright, rabies, yeah, they can get rabies. This is stats from the state lab. And again, you let your cats out at night, look who he's messing with. The three most rabid animals in Massachusetts. So look down here, we've only had 12 coyotes testing positive for rabies. And so, you know, that's pretty important. If you got cats, you should pay attention to that. Keep them in. I'm just going to skip over that. Although I will mention that, you know, coyotes, Lyme disease has to go through a rodent. And so if you have a coyote running around that 90% of his diet is rodents, then
he's going to make a dent in Lyme disease. And Lyme disease is getting epidemic, if you know that. People are getting it all over.
Wait, explain it. Lyme disease can't go through a rodent?
The disease cycle goes through a rodent at some point in time. The tick has got to get on a rodent, and it's got to go in there, all those things. So having coyotes around is a good thing. Wooded areas, this is how we treat them. So why would they live in the woods? They'd much rather live in your nice, groomed backyards. Massachusetts loses 40 acres a day, every single day on average, to development. 40 acres, that's a lot of land. There's a lot of wildlife on land. Wildlife is not going to just lay over and say, okay, I'm dead, I don't have a place to live. Heck no, they're survivalists. They're going to go to your backyard, wherever they got to go to make a living. So be a little bit compassionate of that. Yada, yada, yada. If you feed cats, coyotes aren't going to come for the cats. What does this stuff attract? Rodents. So if you're feeding feral cats, and you've got a ton of cat food laying around, you're going to be drawing rats and mice, and that's just what they like to eat. Let me tell you, I know people say that coyotes are killer cats, and I'm sure they do on occasion. I got two cats that I would pity any coyote messing with. And cats are tough. They're tough, tough animals. When they're out, you know, special feral cats. You ever seen a feral cat? That ear is just, every little noise, they're in tune. And they don't just lay around and walk around. They're like sneaking around. They're tough to get. They're a hard meal for a coyote. Very hard. That's just a picture of a nice blue kind of pretty turkey. But the thing is, well, I'm just getting out of here because I've been rambling, so I got to really wrap up. But this is now a condo complex. That's what we're doing here. We're so overpopulating the planet that all this wildlife, there's no place to go. So, beavers, they'll eat beavers. There's a couple, research papers came out of Canada stating that 14% of the coyote diet was beavers. Chipmunks, they can eat them all, it's fine with me. Skunks, they will eat skunks. The only other animal that eats skunk is?
Fishers.
Great horn up. Yeah. And skunks, they're great little animals. They're docile. I rescue them out of window wells all the time. I'm sure Megan does too. They're great for your lawn. They might make little holes, but they're eating these larvae that hurt your lawn. So if you have, of course, if you have dogs, it's not a good thing. If you walk in your yard and there's a skunk there, he's not going to spray you. You have to threaten him. And he'll warn you. Pat his feet, hiss, twitch his tail. All right. In 13 years, it's just pictures of coyotes all over the place. Well, actually, these are all adult. The parents to this guy was one of the biggest coyotes I've ever seen. I got a picture of him somewhere. He's just panting. He's not growling. He's an old guy. I got a funny story about him, but I can't talk about it. This is the parents of those pups. And both those pups were killed the same summer by cars in the next town. But he was a pretty big coyote. In terms of height, is pretty tall. All right, so I'll field any questions right now. Anyone have any questions? Yes, sir.
How many coyotes killed by police in Massachusetts?
I don't know, but I would say a boatload.
What's the
And it's usually environmental police.
What's the protocol for the police to?
It's not right, I can tell you that. It's usually based on fears, misinformation, and negative.
I'm gonna jump in on North Reading specifically. We actually do not shoot coyotes unless they are sick and down. They have to literally be not moving when we approach them for us to do anything with them. We tell everybody the same thing, harass them, do what you need to do. We will send cruisers out in case we need to, but the only coyotes we have euthanized are young pups that are severely injured or very, very sick with open wounds. So, and we do it as humanely as possible. We actually take them up to the DPW and have it done. So it's not done in people's backyards.
And I got to tell you, that is such an outstanding policy because there are a lot of people don't do that. They don't realize if you go out there and start shooting coyotes, you're just going to have more of them. And people don't understand that, but killing coyotes makes more coyotes and more inexperienced young coyotes that could get into trouble. So here in North Reading, you guys got it made. You got a good ACO, you got a good police department that understands the behavior of these animals. So it's a good thing. Yes, ma'am.
Very ironic because right before I came to the meeting, before the sun went down, two very large coyotes off just walking across Eisenhower Pond. Several neighbors got in touch with each other. They're just hanging out in the lawn. And ironically, there's, and I think Megan knows about this, there's a deer carcass like 30 feet off the road.
Yeah.
Ripped apart, maybe killed naturally or something, and the coyotes are eating it, but.
Yeah, any hunters in here? I'm not anti-hunter. I think if you want to stalk your prey and kill it and bring it home and eat it, I think that's okay. I'm not cool with bow hunting, and I absolutely hate trappers. But coyotes are not killing deer like hunters believe they are. They swear by it. They think they're taking all their deer away. They're not. They will kill a few fawns in the spring, but other than that, the only coyotes, the only deer that they will take down is a lame deer, one that can't run away, which presents an opportunity for them to kill it, or if it's sick, or you know, or dead already. A lot of them get hit by cars, they run off the road, and they die of internal injuries, and the coyotes feast on them. But they're not taking adult, healthy deer. Yes, ma'am.
Can you, this is a stupid question.
No, that's not stupid.
How do you distinguish a wolf from a coyote?
You could answer that one.
Wolves are like huge. They're like, what's the average weight of your wolves up there?
65 to 85 pounds.
Oh, they're not that big, huh?
No, the biggest one on record was 165 pounds.
Yeah.
So it also depends on the territory and food supply.
Yeah, higher elevations, they tend to get bigger. Yeah. But you're talking about an 85 pound animal compared to 30, 35 at the most.
We could have cattle carcass state forest.
Yep, yeah, been there before.
Right, up here in town. And I wonder if there, if that encourages the coyote to live here, if we have more because of our...
Coyotes are self-regulating animals. They're not going to overpopulate. If food resources are good and high and there's lots of free territory, they'll have higher litters. If food resources are low, like you watch, I bet you this spring all the coyote litters are going to be on the low side because this winter really was a hard winter. So all their prey species are probably, a lot of them have been killed off. So it's tough to feed your pups when there's no food out there. And somehow, Mother Nature, they just kind of know this. Anyway, this is a western coyote. This is what we have that's mixed with wolves, that is now the eastern coyote. So, and I'm sorry there's no scale here, but he's just a hair bigger than a red fox. Yes, ma'am.
I have two questions. I recently heard coyotes barking for the first time. I've heard plenty of yips and howls, and I was wondering if you could say what the three different voices mean. And my other question is, do they use them for different purposes? And
I'm sure they do, but I do not know what, you know. I know that that they'll do the replicating thing usually when they have a kill, which is a defensive posturing. But all the other sounds they make, I have no idea. I know they communicate with each other really well, but you know, what they're saying and when they use it, I don't know.
And then I have a dog and I do a lot of off-leash exercise with her in certain wooded areas where other people go with their dogs. Is it possible to say what are the times you need to be, I'm always cautious in, you know, making sure she's within sight.
How big is the dog?
She's 42 pounds.
What kind of dog is it?
Water poly. So yeah. I know you said January and February is mating season,
yep.
So that would potentially be a dangerous time.
Yep, that
and
would be a time that I'd be really keeping a close eye on her, I'd have a leash.
Okay.
In wooded areas.
And then when the pups are young and the adults are feeding, is that also?
If the dogs are near the den, that could be an issue.
Okay.
And I think Megan was telling me earlier that they had that actual issue here, like farm dens and, you know, dogs would be attacked.
Well, in Linwood's, I think it was 2 years ago, there were several attacks on dogs.
Yeah.
The dogs survived.
Yeah. Usually it's not, it's not a lethal attack. It's get out of my territory,
right,
attack. You know, a lot of dogs get bit, you know, in the hind legs, mm-hmm, and that tells us that he was running, the coyote bit. Coyote is fast. They're one of the fastest animals around, 40 miles an hour, easy. So they can catch just about any dog. So if they really, really wanted to, I think they can really do some damage. And they have. I'm not gonna, you know, sweep it under the rug. They have hurt some dogs before. But you know, daytime you're fairly safe. If people learn about coyotes and start hazing them, then those incidents will go way down. Because as long as a human's there, they're going to say, I'm out of here. So with more people, you know, more people I reach out to and teach about coyotes, I think those incidents are going to start going down.
With my dog while I was out for the night, rather than approaching the coyote, could I just holler at him or something like
that? I recommend if you have a dog, is your dog a small dog?
Yeah, she's a Bichon dog.
Bichon. I would recommend you pick the dog up and just slowly leave the area.
Okay.
Not run away, but slowly leave the area. And keep an eye on him. Just so you know where he's at, for your mental being, so you're not afraid.
Yeah.
But just slowly leave the area. And that's what you should do if you have a small dog. Big dog, you know, I think if he's on a leash, I really wouldn't worry at all about it.
Would you be better to keep the dog on a short leash rather than a long?
Yeah, I'll tell you something. I think 20 feet past you is getting close to fair game area. And they're fast. I have seen these guys kill woodchucks, well, a woodchuck once, and I was just blown away at how fast that kill was. You know, just out of nowhere, grabbed it, shook it, dead. Within a second, it's just unbelievable. So I would just, if you have small dogs, I just recommend you just pick them up, slowly leave the area. Never run, remember that old saying, what runs gets chased. So don't run. And these are just pretty pictures of animals I've taken over the years. For your enjoyment. No more questions? All right, thank you so much for coming. There's, I represent Project Coyote. It's a national organization based out of California, but the director and the founder is Camilla Fox, and she's from Maine. We have a newsletter, electronic newsletter, comes out quarterly. You're welcome to sign up. If there's a sign-up sheet out back in the back of the room, you can sign up and you'll just get, you won't get any spam, you won't get, you know, pounded with emails or whatever. Or you can just go to projectcoyote.org. You can sign up there. You can look at what we've been doing. We've had some great successes over the years. Just recently, Project Coyote was a main instrument in getting the state of California to ban predator hunting contests, which is a huge victory for wildlife. And now they're trying to do the same in other areas. So I would urge you to join Project Coyote. And I really urge you to stand up and know your politicians. Those are the ones that are making the calls. Ask them, call them up. Hey, how do you stand on trapping? I don't know about how you guys feel about trapping, but I think trapping is just disgusting. I mean, dogs get in it, eagles, everything. It's just whatever comes along will get in it. It's ridiculous. So call your representatives, your senators, your congressmen. Tell them, look, how are you voting on this? Do you really want XL pipeline coming through the country and poisoning our water and all that? You know, how do you feel about it? Because if you feel this way, I'm not voting for it. Let them know. Because, you know, they work for us, supposedly. So I always urge people, you know, I want you to see all that. All right. But that's what I was just talking about.